Erwin, are there questions?
Yes, a few questions. First one is about Blavatsky, her relation to the Spiritists. Of course, she was a messenger with an assignment, as you told, that her master asked her, do you want to work for humanity? And was it also the idea of the masters to make a connection with the Spiritists and also the phenomena around that?
Yeah. Well, I think we should keep in mind that there are two aspects. And of course, Blavatsky was having a certain freedom. The assignment of the masters was not, a very narrow assignment. It was a very general, make the people know that this and this exists. And direct yourself to the groups open for it. And that was Blavatsky's judgment to say, okay, well, the Spiritists are open because they already try to communicate with non-material things. Yeah. So that was one thing. And then later on, that was not working out that well. And then the master was saying, okay, try to explain what it is. That was giving quite some negative resistance. She was doing that. And then she stopped in that direction to do all this type of phenomena, to show all the non-material things, because then she was coming to the conclusion, I think she was absolutely right in it, that this is not attracting the people I really want to attract. Because that is more the sensational people what likes to see me and invite me than people having interest and say, can you explain this from theosophical point of view? And what is the meaning of this? And what means this and that, etc., etc. So, and then she stopped that. But of course, in a certain way, it was too late already, because that group was already known and were trying to interfere all the time. Yeah. The same happened with the priests and the churches. She found later on in India a huge amount of resistance over there, because they were trying to make her life as worse as possible. Yeah.
But it was also later on, I think, that one of the masters even said, well, let us prevent to become a sort of school of magic.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah, yeah. I think, thank you, Erwin. That is a very important one, because the attention and the emphasis was so strong on that people were only having, like to have magic after magic and like to learn that magic as well without the consequences. I will come back on the consequences a little bit later, but I will come back on that, yeah?
A bit connected to this question is the question, why was she chosen by the masters to deliver the message? Why Blavatsky?
Yeah, well, that is very nice, especially for the feminist under us. They have searched 100 years, the masters have searched 100 years to find a person having the right, mentality, the right moral qualities to do this type of work. Yeah, and you have to realize they were not only looking in Russia or Europe, they were searching over the whole world to find a person able with the right qualities. And then after 100 years of looking around to find Blavatsky, she was willing to do it, and then they were starting from it. Yeah.
Another question connected with that is that Blavatsky was also born in a troubled time.
Yeah.
So is that something that is also on purpose, that her birth is aligned with the certain time that she was needed for?
Absolutely. The incident during the Baptist was, a very strong indication already, but also the moment I say there were illnesses in that time, epidemias, there were war around in Russia in that time, etc. So everything was in a quite negative, environment. And her father was in the army, has to travel a lot. So mainly she was raised by her grandmother. Her grandmother was a very well studied woman with an excellent library, and she teach Blavatsky at home, because going to schools was almost impossible. And then you have to realize, traveling around in that time, three times the world, a world that was absolutely not at peace. A very strong incident was, she was in 1971 or so, she was traveling from Greek to Egypt on a boat. And that boat was heavily armed, because there were all robberies on the sea over there. And the boat exploded. And Blavatsky was coming ashore without anything, just there. And then she was helped by some people. And very luckily, but later on, she helps dead people as well. And from karmic point of view, that is a very nice situation, because dead people she helped later on as well. You can say as a type of compensate for the karmic help she was getting in Egypt. They were really trying to show that Blavatsky was a fraud and so on and so on. So they were giving a huge problems, yeah?
Another question is, are there any examples of public figures who were interested in the and wanted to participate to join the large study group?
Yeah. Well, if you, I called already his name. I think a very famous one was Alexander Wilder. He was a very well-known prof, a very well-known Platonist, working on the university. Crookes was very well-known. Later on, we have Edison and that type of people. But you see that certainly a certain amount of people from that time, quite advanced in the society, were really taking part of it. Later on as well, in our own society, the Point Loma Society, in the 20s, in 1920 and so on, the King of Sweden was a member of our society. And KT, traveling always to Sweden in the summer period, had a lot of activities with him taking part as well. So, yes, you see all over. A very famous person is, for instance, Mondrian, Piet Mondrian. He was a theosophist, becoming a theosophist here in, at The Hague, in this street, mm-hmm. Yeah, on the other side of this street. And he stayed theosophist his whole life. Take, for instance, Rudolf Steiner, also becoming first a theosophist, later on an anthropocist.
Gandhi.
Was a very famous person. So you see quite an amount of people coming to theosophy, because theosophy was really, how you say that, an eye-opening source of information. If you are really open for new things and rethinking, then I think theosophy was the thing to do. I think still it is nowadays as well, yeah? But if you see in science, later on, in let's say the end of 1989 and so on, people start to discover that matter starts to be radiated. Becquerel is a very good example of it. The Curies are good examples of it. Later on, people like Bohr, Einstein. Einstein was having every 3 or 4 years a new secret doctrine, because he was tearing out pages, making notes in it, and so on. He just lived the secret doctrine, you can say. Yeah.
And there's also someone who has a question in relation to what we said before about this, that the masters had to wait for 100 years to find a suitable person like Blavatsky to do the work of the starting the society. Could we say that HPB was in a certain way an avatar?
Not only in a certain way, but it is part of my second book.
Okay, so a bit patience and then the answer will come. And last question. that someone read in the book by Sylvia Cranston, the biography, that people who were just in her presence experienced something of an atmosphere, a grandeur that made a huge impression, something they found difficult to describe. Can you tell us something about that?
Yeah, that is absolutely true. I think that will also be a part of my second blog, but I let's say a few words about it. What you can see, and that I will explain, is that there was a presence, not only of Blavatsky, but other persons, let's say other human beings of a different, let's say, level of development. And people noticed that there was something. That is something what we can do as well. Sometimes you come somewhere and you notice there is someone around. Yeah, and that is what people notice with Blavatsky as well. Not always, but quite often. Yeah, people observing her writing were really seeing some shadows around her. Yeah, but not able to explain it. And I will give the explanation just in a minute. And that was really true because she was cooperating. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Okay. That were questions.
Okay. Good. I like to address now my second part. I called it H.P. Blavatsky as Tulku. Tulku is a typical Tibetan name. You can find it back in the Mahayana Buddhism of Tibet. And Tulku is a real meaning. Tulku is the Tibetan name. Avesha is the Hindu name. And Avatar is a Hindu name, and so on. But to explain this, you have to listen careful. And if you have doubts about you understand it right, please raise your questions. Because this is really making use of the information Blavatsky brought. Yeah? So only to understand if we take in account that the man is not a physical being, but is a consciousness being, yeah, composed out of a cooperation of different beings. Well, this is something for us, from our Western traditions, we are not raised and grow in this type of ideas. If you are not, let's say, raised in theosophical family, this is something new. So then I think you should really try to understand that what we're saying here is very important and something new. If you don't take this in account, you are not able to understand what is going on and how she was working. Yeah. In our society, we give a course, a study of consciousness, to try to explain how the human thinking is working. And life wisdom is the second one. And that will help you to understand this. It can be a first step to understand this type of things as Tulku, Avesha and Avatars. So, let's see what we can do. First, this diagram is a very simple diagram of a being composed out of three parts. An imperishable part, a learning part, and a transitory part. So, a part what is always there, a part what is growing and developing, and a part what is just temporary and is just supporting, what facilitates us with, let's say, energy and vitality and so on, and a physical body to work with. And these three parts working together, we know this as, in our case, as a man. So, but we have to realize that every animal, every man, every god or super god or whatever, or Buddha or Bodhisattva, is having these three parts. These three parts of presenting a being, a living being, is just a simple part. We know it from the New Testament, from Paul. He gives a little bit other terms on it. We use the threefold as well, because it is the most easier part. You can split this up in more parts, you can even come up with a 12-fold and so on, makes the things, let's say, a little bit more difficult, but to be able to explain some details a little bit better. Yeah, but we have to realize that there is all over cooperation. Each circle on itself is what Blavatsky is calling in the secret doctrine the monad. In my next lecture, 2 weeks from now, I will address that a little bit more. Yeah. So, and now we have to realize that if this is working together as a human being, what was happening in the case of Blavatsky? And in the case of an avatar, in the case of an avesha, yeah? So, and now we have to give attention. I draw 2 times this composition. The composition of a Mahatma, what is called HPB, yeah? A pure human, what is called HP Blavatsky. And what will happen is that the intermediate part, the learning part of the Mahatma, is overshadowing the learning part of Blavatsky. I have called it own intermediate part set aside. Yeah? So, dus on the same moment, the masters were acting like this. Yeah, I use plural on purpose. They put Blavatsky's own learning part on the background. Yeah, and were overshadowing the higher part and the transitorial part of Blavatsky. Yeah, that is not something what was easy to do. That was part of her training in Tibet to make this possible, to learn Blavatsky to work. And when that happens, the masters, of one of the masters, of one of the chelas, overshadowing Blavatsky and were giving Blavatsky information. Sometimes as text, more or less dictated. Sometimes as a picture. She has to do describe herself and put on paper, for instance, for secret doctrine, Eisenfeld, or whatever. Yeah. And so, and that is the reason that she has to be trained, because she should be able to receive that information in the purest form as possible. Yeah. And that is an important thing, because sometimes everybody can have an idea, and maybe can have an idea what is not coming from himself. Yeah. But did we receive it in the pure state, without any, let's say, manipulation, without any corruption, etc., etc.? And that is what people were seeing. Is Blavatsky was in this condition, and she was quite often, there's all the things like Eisenfeld, but also the secret doctrine, key to theosophy, etc., etc. She was working, and the people were doing the observation, were really seeing that she was everything putting on paper. Sometimes they had the idea that there was something present. Sometimes there was a vague shadow around her, etc., etc. And that was the moment she was in cooperation with the Mahatma, one of the Mahatmas. If we speak about an avatar, yeah, then the learning part is not so much overshadowing, but the, let's say, the higher, the imperishable part is overshadowing and is giving information. And then we speak about an avatar. So the term avatar in the theosophical literature is really something, really an influence of a divine person, a divine being, sorry, person is not right, a divine being, overshadowing an intermediate learning part completely. Yeah. So if we are normal human beings, reasonably developed, we have now and then an influence from our higher part. But if you speak about an avatar, there is a complete overshadowing. Yeah. So you find in the theosophical literature that Jesus, the Nazarene, was an avatar. Krishna was an avatar. Yeah. And to make it more difficult, We have two type of avatars, an overshadowing of your own higher nature of overshadowing of an other higher nature. But here, if we speak about Tulku, is that to be the learning part of a high developed being, overshadowing the learning part of a very advanced human being like HPB. I hope I make it clear. We have to be careful with the term Tulku. We use it in our literature, let's say, very well-defined. In our literature from Dr. De Peruker, we have from this series of esoteric teachings, 12 volumes, volume 10, is completely addressed this situation and explained it very clearly and very much in detail, addressed all the things like avatar, tulkus, aveshas, and other types of, let's say, light forms of this. So feel free if you have questions. So if you look who are able to make use of Blavatsky in this condition, you have to realize, of course, that should be people able of doing this, sending out clear pictures to other beings, able to receive them, start to work with them, put them on paper, work them out as text, etc., etc. So, what you say, we see two levels of people working with Blavatsky, what I have called co-workers, theosophists, etc., working with her, and members of the Lodge of Wisdom and Compassion working through her. Yeah? And then you see the masters, the chelas, and the very advanced lay chelas of the masters who are able doing this. Yeah? So, and this is a thing, what we have to realize, that the whole amount of work Blavatsky was doing on the end of this block, I will coming back on that, is she was, how do you say that, a portal for a complete organization behind her. But that I will address in the last block, yeah? So, and this is an important thing. You can ask yourself, is that only happening in Blavatsky? Well, in fact, today, this principle still works as well. And we can see it in our society, most of the time in negative form, that one person, a very strong thinker, overshadowed a weak person and put aside his free will, put aside his independent thinking, because he is completely overshadowed. You can see in the modern advertisement, in the modern PR world, they can go very far by putting one man's thinking aside and overshadowing him with ideas that he sometimes even don't realize. He's coming in a shop and then he has a recognition in the store and say, oh yes, that is something what I know, that is what I need. Seen it for the first time of his life, because the PR was so strong that they really imposed in his thinking this image of this product. Yeah, this is of course not the way we like to do this. This is taking away free will and, let's say, the independent way of thinking, and that is what we called black magic in a negative way, what you not should do at all. So, if we speak about Tulku and Avatar, that only can be do if you do this on free will basis. Yeah. So Blavatsky was trained. She was really aware of it, that it was her own responsibility to be, let's say, a channel for the masters, but also give her a direct responsibility. Because if she was receiving it and she was not writing it in the right way, it is, of course, Blavatsky's own responsibility that she was making mistakes and maybe bringing out misunderstandings, yeah? What has to be correct later on. And it happens a number of times. So if you see this type of knowledge, yeah? And Blavatsky already speak about this type of knowledge very early in the beginning of 1875. She writes an article in The Spiritualist and under a pseudonym. And then she say, in fact, I teach occultism. And if you look, occultism, the word means something very simple. It means, the original meaning is the science of hidden, sacred things. But we have to realize one thing. Blavatsky's definition has a much deeper meaning. Because he say, occultism, as a rule, is a dangerous double-edged sword for one who is not prepared to devote his whole life to it. While his whole life, what he tries to say, as soon as you start to build up knowledge of this, you cannot apply this knowledge. So van, okay, this fits me very well. And on the daily life, I do all negative things. I do manipulation of human beings, etc., etc., because that gives me profit. She tries to say, if you build up knowledge of the occultism, so that means how things are working, how conscious beings are cooperating with each other, and you start to use that for own profit, yeah, and not in the general, profit of humanity, etc., then you should realize that you are building up yourself quite some strong negative karma. Yeah? And that is the reason that she say, true occultism is defined in Blavatsky words as altruism, the great renunciation of self. From the principle the divine is hidden, transcendent, and yet immanent in every living being. Or, say it in my words, don't use the forces, the divine forces, for your own purpose. That will not work out very well. You have to realize that the teaching Blavatsky was giving out in started in 1875 starts on a certain level. And if you read all the publications of Blavatsky, you see that she is really working on the fact that if people start to understand the things better, she can make use of that situation and give a little bit more. So in fact, you see from 1875 till 1995, she starts to give more, let's say, deeper information. Because she say, you cannot give information if the people are not able to understand it. Because that is not without any risk. It is very risky to do that. So she say, you have to look, and people should be able and ready to understand this. And that brings her in the situation in 88, where she do two very important things in that year. She published the Secret Doctrine, volume 1 and 2, not 3 and 4. Because she mentioned, she say, I will work on an, let's say, alternative of Isis Unveiled, and that she already mentioned very early. She starts speaking about this in 1879 already, that she all works, will work on a new, let's say, book, a new publication. Yeah. And she said, yeah, that will be four volumes, volume 1, 2, 3, and 4. And so everybody expected four volumes. But she published in 88 two volumes. Because she said, for volume 3 or 4, people are not yet ready. Yeah. But she do another important thing. She established the esoteric school called the ES. She makes an announcement in her magazine Lucifer, saying that she are setting up a school, an ES, and everybody is invited to be a member if you are willing to fulfill the following rules. And she published a month of rules, also the pledge, what has to be taken. And if you read that pledge, that is what you then see, is requiring a certain quality of life and certain quality of handled theosophical information. She established the AS as an independent organization, free from the Theosophical Society, but the members are not free. You can only be a member of the ES if you are also a member of the Theosophical Society. But the ES Society of Organization is not connected to the Theosophical Society. One of the explanations they give is say, what I need is a backbone for the future, a group of people, very strong from mental point of view, what always will uphold the Theosophical teachings in a most pure form and keep it alive. And that was the whole intentions behind it. Yeah, keep in contact with the masters, etc., etc. Stay working for the masters. Stay working for humanity in the general definition. Yeah. So, and that is what she really expect. But what we see, and that is not something new, that in that whole occultism, everybody who steps in it works out his strong side and his weak side. So we have to work with the strong side, and that everybody takes for granted. But also we have to address our weak side and have to correct it and train that so that we are able to keep up the required mentality. So I just put it out in this diagram, again with the threefold, and say the learning part can be directed to the spiritual, imperishable part, or the learning part can be directed to the transcendental part. Of course, we need food, we need clothes, etc. So it is not saying that you should not be eating and dressing yourself, but it should be not the purpose in life. The purpose in life should be directing on the higher parts and try to work out and make the learning part learning as fast as possible to become a pure human being in the shortest period. Yeah. So this is mind part two, speaking about Blavatsky as Stulku, as intermediate. And in the third part, I will be speaking as Blavatsky as a spiritual transformer. And then I will address also what is more behind her than we normally see on the outer side. So, 3 minutes break, then your questions. I will answer them, and then the third part.
Is an avatar more or less the same as a medium?
No, no. If you remember mine diagram, the three one, a medium is in fact, and believe it or not, a part that belongs to the transition part, so the lower part, the highest side of the lower part. Yeah. And how can you say that? It is a type of energy in the human being. You can say the habits what are really there for a very long time. It is like you have with a diesel engine or a petrol engine or whatever. It runs for a while. If you switch it off, it can still run for a few moments because on his own heat and energy. And that is in fact what a medium is. And and that is the lower part, let's say, of the after-running lower part of the transition part. So it is exactly the opposite direction, yeah? If you have experience with it, look for yourself. You will never get high spiritual answers and questions answered by this type of medium because they don't have that experience. If you raise a very difficult question, what was coming up in your mind for the first time, and you ask that question, they are not able to answer that. Just to give you a little bit of idea. So you have to keep a good difference because avatar is a real high spiritual being, yeah? And that is not only the outer part of a Jesus, no, it is the higher part of the Jesus, yeah? What he called my God, yeah? And that is even for us, our higher part is the avatar, that is our divine part in the most capital letters written. So it is quite a contrast, yeah.
So you have, let us say, the spiritual immortal part, learning part and the transitory part, And if the immortal part is replaced, then we have an avatar. If the learning part is replaced, then we have Tulku. And then if a transitory part is replaced, then we have a medium.
Perfect.
Okay. Would you recommend the Secret Doctrine commentaries?
Absolutely. Because the Secret Doctrine in itself is a huge challenge to study. If you study the Secret Doctrine, the best thing what you can do is doing the prone, the first part. The part was what, on a request written by Blavatsky as a type of intro, but it is perfect because it is explaining the complete, let's say, deeper meaning of the Theosophia. There is another part on the first volume, page 272, the summary of Blavatsky. And later on, she had the Blavatsky Lord study group, and they were able, in that study with Blavatsky, to raise questions about the Secret Doctrine. From that meeting evenings, there is make short notes. That short note is republished in the book volume that called the Secret Doctrine Commentaries. Very valuable, because Blavatsky answer questions about what is the Ahia? What would we think about this? What would we think about that? Because in the Secret Doctrine, there is a huge amount of ideas and definitions we have in the Western world no experience with. So we have to invent ourselves an image around that. How will this look and how will this work? And the commentaries is a very good help in that. Yeah, there is one thing you should keep in mind. The commentaries are published. It is in cooperation we have done with Comus. And have collected it. And it is the shorthand as it is. We have not investigated things like capital letters and non-capital letters. So if you want to have, do we write it with a capital? You have to look in the Secret Doctrine. But there is, you say, the very good open discussions with Blavatsky. And Blavatsky is sometimes very direct. Yeah. If people start to ask a question for the second or the third time, then she is can be very direct to say, hey, it becomes time that you start to think. I have already answered two times now, so start thinking for yourself. Yeah. So quite direct. But it is perfect to be read. Yeah.
Someone asked,
maybe a good thing is that you can order it by our society. We sell it on this moment for a very low price, just 10 euros.
Yeah, that's quite a difference. Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay. Someone also asked, I thought there's also a volume 3 of the Secret Doctrine.
Yeah, good question. On the moment, Blavatsky was dying in 1891. There were only official published volume 1 and 2. But everybody knowing that Blavatsky was saying, yeah, there should be in volume 3 and 4 as well. And she say, yes, the content is ready as well. Then you can ask yourself, the content already written out? Or the idea what the content should be? And let's say in pictures it is there. So what happens? Blavatsky died. People addressing her working room find all piles of text, and some people come to the conclusion and say, oh, this must be volume 3. This must be volume 3. They start to collect that pile of information, bind it together, and the ADR Society has published that under the name Volume 3. Boris Sinikov, the guy who investigated almost his whole life in bringing all the publications of Blavatsky's together, gives a very nice explanation and say, no, it can be true that some parts were intended for being part of Volume 3. And he gives an example. There is a very famous article on her desk called The Life of Buddha, something like 30, 40 pages, very difficult to read. He say that article is certainly not ready. There are a lot of typing problems in it, and so on, and so on. And maybe it was intended, but certainly not in this way. If you like to understand that article, and you read the Esoteric Tradition, volume 10 of GDP, and you study that volume first, Bruker needs something like 180 pages, just 180 pages for it, and you start to read that article, Life of Buddha, again, then you see everything is clear, because she writes it in a very, very compact way. But if you have the background of that study in volume 10 of GDP, then you can understand that article really very well. So, you can also ask yourself, are there valuable things in it? Yes, of course, but keep in mind, it was maybe not ready for publication yet.
Someone asks, who exactly are the masters? Should I view them as higher monads who are further developed than we are, and therefore have gone beyond the world we as humans live on, but are still helping us?
Yeah, I think that is a correct interpretation. We can say the masters are, let's say, advanced human beings, but we have to keep in mind that also within the rank of the masters, we have different levels. Advanced masters, just masters, chelas, lay chelas. There is also quite a range in it. So you have masters still having a human body. You have masters, they don't need the body anymore, called Nirmanikayas, etc. So, and we have a very, very advanced one, what is called the Maha Chohan, the master of the masters, yeah? And one of the phrases is, the one who in his eye, the future is just an open book, yeah? So, keep in mind, a complete range of beings willing to help humanity, and then I will explain that a little bit more in the last part, and working on all different levels, cooperating with Blavatsky today and tomorrow something else, and so on. It's a very dynamic organization working all over the world, not only through the Theosophical Society alone, but also wherever human being can be helped.
Another question is, could we say that Blavatsky gave the atmic view of Theosophia that could be given?
Yeah, that is certainly true. She will give it out for the coming 9 to 10, 30,000 years, is say. Yeah. So that means that the whole content of the publications, what is going on, is a source of information for, let's say, 10,000 years or so in our human evolution. Yep. If we are able to keep it pure.
Mm-hmm. And could we have moments in our life, just as human beings as we are, where we can represent something like a tulku mentality?
I hesitate a little bit. In principle, yes, but then we should realize that we should be pure of mentality, able to receive certain spiritual influences. So the wise thing is always check what is coming in. Is it really high spiritual? Yeah. Is it really in the advanced of all human beings? All. Not only a small group or a certain person, but in all, for all human beings. Is it really giving advanced information so that you can accelerate your evolution and can be in service for your human being? So these are all, let's say, pre-requirements to see what is coming in myself. Because we as human beings, we can be open and we can receive a lot of, ideas coming from outside, but it is no guarantee that they are of a high quality level. Yeah. So be careful by this.
But could you also say that there are people in the world, like artists or writers or scientists, philosophers, without them knowing, are inspired by people like the masters of...
Yes, that is possible. One of the masters write in his letters. His letters you can easily read because they are published in a book, the Mahatma letters. And she say, one of the masters say, we don't force, we inspire. So that means you have to be open. If you take some things in science, in this case, you take this Einstein, his idea of relativity. Relativity is a very theosophical idea. Yeah, is he inspired? Maybe. Yeah. Crookes with his tubes. Is he inspired? Yes, they have inspired him a little bit here and there. But of course, there is always a danger of this type of inspiration misuse. So they really like to have guarantees in moral and ethical stability before they do it on, let's say, a big scale.
Okay, last question. In light of our compassionate characteristic, can Blavatsky now still be actively working, but then on the inner realms right now?
Yeah. You know, this is always discussions where you can easily put question marks around it. But Dr. Peruka makes in the early 30s a remark and say, HPB, not Blavatsky, HPB is active again. Yeah? And that means that the force behind H.P. Blavatsky, yeah, means that was taking his rest and is now active again. And he is not saying he is incarnated again. He says he is active again. Yep. So.
Okay. Those were the questions.
Okay. Good. Well, the last one. I will try to address an